Hey guys, welcome back to my August wrap-up reading vlog. This month has been a bit hectic for me, so I've only really read like 2 new books and the rest of them are just like plays. So here are the physical books that I've read. I've read Macbeth and A Streetcar Named Desire before, and I've also raved about them on my channel before, so I'm not going to go into much detail about them. In terms of The Kite Runner, it's about this young boy who has to navigate his life after he betrays his childhood best friend. I've also been reading this digital version of Tim Winton's The Turning, which is a short story collection. The one that I really like the most is Aquifer, and I find that it has a lot of interesting parallels with The Kite Runner, which is what I'll be talking about in my vlog today, because they have a lot of similarities in like their genre, in their content, in their symbolism, but more importantly, I'll be looking at how they both use a circular narrative structure and how they also use development of setting to construct the two texts differently. I'll just be analyzing that because, you know, I'm a bit of a nerd like that, and if you're on my channel, you probably know that, so let's just get into this. The development of setting is also similar in both Aquifer and in The Kite Runner. In Aquifer, the setting is destroyed or changed through progression, whereas in The Kite Runner, the setting is destroyed or changed through regression. Both stories achieve a similar effect where the main characters discover that their old childhood homes have been changed irrevocably, just like them. In Aquifer, the narrator says that as they moved in, people planted buffalo grass and roses and rubber trees that wreaked havoc on the septics a decade later. So here we see that the suburb which the narrator grew up in has been replaced by an artificial version of itself by putting rubber trees that are unnatural and everlasting. Additionally, the terms straight lines are often used to reference the suburbs. So for example, the suburbs straighten the bush out, or the straight lines gave way to the natural scruffiness of Australia, where there is this juxtaposition between the straight, unnatural lines of the suburb and the untamed wilderness of natural Australia. The wilderness of the narrator's childhood suburb has been pushed back. It's been tamed by gentrification. Middle-class people are moving in and gentrifying this neighborhood by planting exotic trees or remodeling houses to add a second story. So this way, we see that the neighborhood of the narrator's childhood is gone, not torn down or destroyed, but rather replaced by a shallow iteration of itself. In The Kite Runner, the setting is destroyed through war. When Amur and Farid goes back to Kabul, Amur notices that all the trees are cut down, and Farid tells him that it is because people are using the wood from the trees to either make fires or to stop the Taliban from hiding snipers in it. This destruction of nature is not done to clean up or prettify Kabul, unlike in Aquifer, but rather it is a necessity for survival. The Taliban has, in essence, taken away Amur's childhood Kabul from him. Additionally, there is the pomegranate tree which symbols Amur and Hassan's childhood, where they used to sit under the tree and read to each other. When Amur returns to his house, he says that the pomegranate tree is wilted, it is leafless, it looks like it hasn't borne fruit in years. He also finds the carved message, Amur and Hassan, the sultans of Kabul. It is a reminder for Amur to move forward, to redeem himself for Hassan. The destruction of the setting in Kite Runner presents this forlorn idea where Amur must face his present in the form of the destroyed Kabul and his destroyed childhood home in order to move forward and redeem himself, tying it back to the idea that redemption can only be learned when one stops wallowing in the past. In conclusion, both Aquifer and The Kite Runner develop the setting negatively as a way to show the progression of characters and the destruction of their childhood. Though the developments are different, the end result is the same. The main characters both have to face the future, live in the present, and not return to the childhood that have already been. Both Aquifer and The Kite Runner start with the narrators looking back in time and then using flashbacks to tell the narrative, So it comes a full circle in what is formally known as a circular narrative structure. In Aquifer, the opening paragraph ends with the quote, "Life moves on," people say, but I doubt that. Moves in, more like it. The unnamed narrator then starts reminiscing about his childhood suburb and then reverses the neighborhood to recount the events of the past, or more specifically, to recount Alan Mannering's death, which he witnessed as a child. The story then resolves with the narrator heading back to his present home, reflecting that the past is in us, not behind us. Things are never over. This draws back to the idea that you cannot move on from the past that is presented in the opening paragraph of Aquifer. This way, the narrator ends the story with exactly how it began, befittingly states that the time stays with you, stays in you forever, just like how Alan Mannering's death stays with them even after all those years. In The Kite Runner, the opening paragraph directly parallels Aquifer, where Amur says that it's wrong what they say about the past, I've learned, about how you can bury it, because the past claws its way out. Both narrators talk about how the past doesn't move on and how you can't run away from it. Both stories start with the narrators reflecting on the past, but Aquifer's narrator describes time as moving inwards, as staying with you, while Amur describes time as being violent, as clawing its way out. Amur's statement is supported through his character development throughout the story. No matter how hard he tries, he cannot move on from the sin of standing by while Asaf sexually assaults Hassan. His actions come in a full circle, which is demonstrated by the repeated phrase, "For you, 1,000 times over." It is first said by Hassan to Amur, pledging the loyalty and allegiance before he goes and runs for the kite that Amur had cut down at the tournament and subsequently get raped by Asaf. At the end of the novel, the phrase "for you 1,000 times over" is repeated by Amur to Sohrab, who is Hassan's son, in an almost role reversal, with Sohrab, Hassan's legacy, holding the position of power above Amur, whereas before Hassan was below Amur and Amur held the power. Additionally, The Kite Runner ends with the simple sentence, "I ran." Just like how Amur ran away when he witnessed Asaf assaulting Hassan. When Amur runs away the first time, it is out of fear and he has to live with the guilt of running away forever. At the end, however, Amur is running towards the kite that he and Sohrab cut down together at a local friendly kite running match, and he runs towards his redemption instead of his ruination. In Aquifer, the narrator is static and maintains that you cannot move on from the past, while in The Kite Runner, Amur essentially moves on from the past by reversing his role with Sohrab. Despite using the same circular narrative structure, the narrator in Aquifer cannot move on, while Amur can, and that is the ultimate difference between these two stories. So that concludes my August wrap-up, guys. I know this is a bit of a wacky, out of ordinary video, but I hope you guys enjoyed it. Unfortunately, due to time constraints, I couldn't really go into depth about the similarities and differences between Aquifer and The Kite Runner. I couldn't really talk about like their symbolism of water, their discussion of authority figures, or their inner character conflicts, or lack thereof in Aquifer. But I hope you enjoyed it nevertheless.
So thank you guys for watching, and make sure to subscribe.
Only a small percentage of you guys are subscribed right now, so if you're not, make sure to hit that subscribe button, and I'll see you guys next time.